بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. وعباد الرحمن الذين يمشون على الأرض هونا وإذا خاطبهم الجاهلون قالوا سلاما.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فإن خير الحديث كلام الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. We spoke before about the significance of knowledge in our religion, and that our religion is based on knowledge, on evidence, and that even when one is trying to follow the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, especially when he's trying to follow the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they have to seek evidence in what they're following. Meaning, whatever action or statement ascribed to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we have to make sure it is authentic. The scholars of Islam throughout history made sure that the information about the religion remained intact for the generations to come, so that they can transfer the knowledge of Islam to the next generation. And among what they did is that they verified the stories and the statements that are ascribed to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and make sure that whatever has to do with the religion is coming through an authentic source. And that source, which we call a sanad, is a very important scientific method that no other religion or ummah ever had. We mentioned before that the ummah that came before our Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala entrusted them with the job of protecting and preserving the religious books and information and sunnah that he sent down to their prophets. And they did a miserable job. They hid some of the revelation, sold some of it for money, and changed a lot. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran that they changed their books with their own hands. Once Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma was told about some people who are studying the Old Testament and the New Testament. And he said, "Why are you doing that? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran that they changed their books with their own hands. And you see none of them studying your book. So why are you studying theirs?" Look at the wisdom here. You don't see them study your book for religious benefit. Maybe they study it just to find errors in it, as they think. But they don't study it for religious benefit, for us to come today and say, we can use these books for religious rulings. This is what some person said. There's no need to mention the name. This is a really, really wicked statement. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent his Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with the religion that is the muhaymin, the dominant, above all other religions. The Quran that's dominant above all other books. So the Quran is dominant and overrules the original books Allah sent, which is his own kalam still, it's his own words. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the Quran dominant above all the other books that came before. And these are the original books that Allah has, haven't been changed or corrupted. What about those that have been changed and corrupted? You see here the difference? So the scholars of Islam made clear, sure, that we don't follow the same trap. The difference here is very obvious. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it his job to preserve the Quran and Sunnah from corruption. And to do that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raised the generation that protected those two resources from corruption. So now, as compared to before, there is a promise from Allah that he will protect our revelation, the revelation that came to our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then we see the result, the fruit of this promise today. Today we have access to the entire sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the entire sunnah. And to the Quran, letter by letter. And to its meaning too. So the knowledge of Islam, which has to do with the faith, The written word, spoken word, the action has been preserved for us from corruption. And this is a miracle from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the method that the scholars use to protect the sunnah, preserve the sunnah from corruption, which is the change of narration, no other ummah has. And this is why they can't come and say, well, we are sure that Jesus said this or Musa said this. They have no proof. They can produce even a page that is original that from their books. Even the books that have been written in the name of Isa alayhi salam, like the Gospels and the tens of books in the Old Testament, they are all ascribed to a person. The Gospel of John, the books of before, Habakkuk or whatever, you know, that they have names that some of them are strange. We don't know who these people are. They can't really ascertain for sure who wrote these books, what's their name, full name, where did they live, what time frame, which language, who translated it into what language. They have no clue, they have nothing. The entire, or the two religions, that are Judaism and Christianity, they come together, put all their efforts to produce an original page of anything, even from the books that were written by people. They are not from Allah. You see, those books that you have in the Old Testament and New Testament, they were written by people. This is not the revelation from Allah. Isa alayhi salam has never seen with his own eyes any of those Gospels, 300 of them, let alone, you know, the many more manuscripts that are portions of the New Testament. He hasn't seen them. It's not about a revelation. The revelation that came to Isa, instructions from Allah for the Muslims in his time as to what to do. It's not about his biography. You see, the Gospels, the biography of Isa, a story. But what Allah revealed, which is Al-Injil, to Isa alayhi salam, is a book of religious instructions. Where is it? It doesn't exist anymore. I'm really sad to see Muslims equate the Old Testament with the Torah and the New Testament with the Injil. I mentioned now that they have no connection to these books. They have no idea who wrote them really. And they ascribe a name to these books and they have no clue who that name is. Who gave him? Let's suppose, you know, a few hypocrites sat and they hate Isa alayhi salam. And that's what happened. And they wrote something and they changed the religion of Isa. And then the next generation, two, three generations, this is from Isa. You see how ended, you know, the fabrications ended up being the religion of Isa alayhi salam. And it is really sad to see some Muslims equate the Old Testament to the Torah and the New Testament to the Injil. No. The Torah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a book of religious instruction. It talks about aqidah as our Quran does, about the past, the present, the future, about Allah's promises and warnings, about Jannah, about Nar, and about what to do in life. Where is that book? It doesn't exist anymore. Let me tell you about the five books of Moses, that they call them the five books of Moses. It's a joke. First of all, they have no clue who wrote this in any time frame, which original language, who translated them, which authority do they have, were they righteous or wicked. Those books are stories about the children of Israel, the number of their tribes, sub-tribes, how many camels and cows and chickens they have. Stories. It's a biography written by people who really, really screwed up here, I'm sorry to say it, but it is, the mental capacity is, like for example, they claim that before the children of Israel had a million soldiers from Ethiopia of today killed in one day. Now imagine those days, you know, today China, as big as it is, it has a million soldiers. You know, it is a major, major task to have a soldier in today's world, let alone before. Imagine Ethiopia having a million soldiers 5,000-6,000 years ago attacking Gaza. Million soldiers going all the way to the north to Gaza to attack the children of Israel to die in one day. So the people who wrote these things, they are messed up here. The stories that they make, they don't make any sense, because in all of Africa, maybe there were 10 million people then. How did Ethiopia have a million soldiers? It means they had 20, 30 million people living there, and they took all the food they needed for the long trip, all the food and transportation and water. This is ridiculous. It never happened. It's a fabrication. The five books of Musa, they are ascribed to Musa alayhi salam. They end up with a very, very strange statement. I don't understand how these generations of Christians and Jews, they come to today and they don't read the last sentence. And Moses was 120 years old when he died. How did he write that? How can this be a statement from the book of Moses? And the style of this sentence and what comes after it is the same style throughout the book. So Musa, when he died, how did he write? And Musa was 120 years old when he died. Did he tell the angel, just wait a minute, let me write this before you kill me? It's really ridiculous, you know. In our religion, the Sanad comes and gives you the information you need about the text and how it reached the scholar. And this is why the scholars of Islam have this extremely scientific method. There is nothing similar to it in all of history. My teacher told me that his teacher said that the Sahabi of Rasulullah SAW, that Rasulullah SAW said. And then all of these people mentioned in the Sanad, they have a verifiable biography. So we know exactly who they are, if they're trustworthy or not. We know their teachers and their students and the legacy they left behind. For example, just like Imam Ahmad radiallahu anhu, Imam al-Bukhari has a few ahadith that are called thulathiyat. Meaning what? Between him and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, only three narrators. Look how precious this is, really precious. Between him and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, only three people, three narrators. So those thulathiyat that Imam al-Bukhari has in his Sahih, to us, it's just like a treasure. Between him and Rasulullah ﷺ, only his teacher, and the Sahabi, then Rasulullah ﷺ. Like that hadith he collected from Salama ibn al-Akwa, from his student, from the teacher of Imam al-Bukhari. Now, these three people mentioned in this hadith, for example, that I just mentioned, where it's narrated from Salama ibn Akwa, from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The people in the chain of narration, they are scholars of Islam. So, al-Bukhari said, this hadith reached me through these people. But the people that are mentioned in this hadith, we go to every one of them, we find they are imams of Islam, with known date of birth, with a known date of, you know, expiration, death. Plus, about the legacy, their knowledge, their teachers, their students, their books, and their trustworthiness. So, an entire legacy you find there, that is a network. So, I might start with a hadith that I can recite in a minute, from the beginning to end, or a couple of minutes. But, to verify, to research, I would need a lot more time than 2 minutes, because each one of these people, I would love to sit and read about their legacy, about their knowledge, what they left behind, about their teachers, the students, what they said about them, about their trustworthiness, about admiring how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala kept the religion for me through this very important, very clear way of reciting, of narration. So those ahadith, they reached the Imam who wrote them in his book through a sanad, the chain of narration. Each one in the chain of narration has a verifiable biography that we know exactly who he is. If we don't, we don't accept the hadith. If the narrator has weakness, it will be reported to us. So then, based on this, there are so many scholars wrote books and books about ilm al-rijal, knowledge of narrators, not only men and women. So, to support that al-Bukhari wrote, and Imam Ahmad, and Nasa'i, Muslim, all these scholars of hadith, we have books that talk about the narrators that are there. Imam al-Mizzi, who is the father-in-law of Imam ibn Kathir, the student of Imam ibn Taymiyyah ibn al-Qayyim, Imam al-Mizzi was a major scholar of hadith. He wrote very beneficial books. He collected a book about the shuyukh of Imam al-Bukhari, 1,080 shuyukh. Imam al-Bukhari said, I learned with more than 1,000 shuyukh, each one of them is a narrator of hadith. So that you have scholars now coming and say, who are the shuyukh of Bukhari? Over 1,080 people. Subhanallah. Now after centuries we come here today, we might look at Sahih al-Bukhari, this and that.
You have no idea the amount of effort that was put there, so that when you sit and say, Imam al-Bukhari said, and you narrate the text, you are receiving fresh information about Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam through the generations that reached you through the efforts of generations and generations of scholars. And therefore, when you look at the ayah, إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا الذِّكْرَ وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ It is us who send down al-dhikr, meaning the Qur'an and Sunnah, and we protect it from corruption. You say, Allahu Akbar. We see it today in front of our own eyes. If you need information about how Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam conducted himself even in his intimate moments with his wives, we have information. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave his Rasul 9 wives. Each one of them narrated precious knowledge to us about how Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam conducted himself at home. Because our religion, we said, is an entire way of life. It includes the bedroom too, and the bathroom. How you do things at home, how you deal with your wife. We can't get this information through men. It has to come through the wives of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his female relatives. So the 9 wives of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they all had access to their own friends from the Medina, their female friends, who would come to them and ask them about, what did Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say about this? What did he do about this? Or they come to them to ask Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam questions. You see, so an entire part of our religion came through women, the wives of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's why he had 9, among the reasons, of course. One of them is that each one of them had her own friends, female friends from the Medina, who felt comfortable asking them about the religion instead of another wife. Also, you have Aisha radiallahu anha, who Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam married at a very young age. She remained for decades after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, narrating to us knowledge that we could never have received except through her. This is why Imam Al-Qayyim rahimahullah said, the most knowledgeable Muslim woman of all time is Aisha radiallahu anha. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهِ الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين وبعد. So brothers, when we pick up a book about the Sunnah, whether it is a book of fiqh, where it says in the end, رواه البخاري مسلم واعتبر books of hadith, and we see these names there, we should remember the ayah, إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا الذِّكْرَ وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala entrusted the people before to preserve the revelation, and they did a very miserable job, and entrusted to no one except himself subhanahu wa ta'ala the preservation of the book, but he raised for that men. You see here? So you have men here who were entrusted with the job, they did a very bad job. You have men here who Allah raised for the ummah to keep the revelation intact until today. So when we look at these books, look at the, you know, remember all what I said. I might find 6-7 narrators for Imam Muslim in some of his ahadith, between him and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Each one of them is a precious stone in this building that we call the Sunnah, that was perfectly fits its place, because from above to below, this person conveyed, and it was preserved for us. And the effort put in there to have this knowledge is so much, so tremendous, you can't imagine. This is why, brothers, we keep telling people who are not Muslim, you might not like the religion, it's your decision. But what you see today is what Rasulullah ﷺ said or did before. And therefore, it is fresh. I know of a person who had a high position in government, British guy. I haven't met him now in over 20 years. But he became Muslim, mashallah. And he chose a good name, Islamic name for himself, which we should all do. It's not required, but it is recommended that when they become Muslim, they choose a good name, Islamic name. And I asked him, why did you become Muslim? He said, the first thing that struck me about the Quran is that it is fresh. It is original. It's not like our books. We don't know who wrote them and have no idea what's going on with, you know, who wrote these books. We have no clue. But the Quran, we know that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said these very words. And he said this is the first thing that struck me about the religion. Then he studied about the religion and became Muslim. which is subhanallah, I think you know, when somebody reaches an age, a certain age, some people think I can't learn anymore. That's not true. This guy was 20 years ago older than me today. So Allah knows if he's still alive or died. But it is really incredible how people look at our religion and find that, because it is original. It is the same book that Muhammad ﷺ came with, same book he narrated or talked to his Sahaba, same Sunnah. It is subhanAllah ta'ala, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that we have this treasure today. So the word sanad, when you hear it from now on, think about these aspects that I spoke about today, about the effort, about the scientific method that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us, about the people who protected the religion for us, so that when you see or look at Sahih al-Bukhari from now on, or Sahih Muslim, or the Muslim Imam Ahmad, Muwatta' Malik, or the other books of hadith, you look at it and say, this is a miracle that I see in my own, with my own eyes, in my own time. This is a miracle from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about the Ummah of Muhammad, especially the Sahaba, كُنْتُمْ خَيْرَ أُمَّةٍ أُخْرِجَتْ لِلنَّاسِ. You always were, will always be the best Ummah to have ever been raised for mankind. Why? This is among the efforts they made. So we can't look down at these books and see that so many Muslims today, they're not really interested in these books. They don't really read them. They don't reach out to them. And you might tell somebody, well, Imam al-Bukhari, is in Bukhari what? You see what I'm saying here? So look what Allah gave to the Ummah, and look to how large sections of the Ummah today, they don't care about it. But they should all receive the good news. Allah promised to protect this religion. So whether these people do their job or not, the religion will continue until the day Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala removes knowledge from earth entirely. One day will come when people will open the book, the Quran, and find nothing there. And when they want to recite from heart, they find nothing in their memory. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will remove his words, the Quran, from earth. That day, inshallah, will not be alive then. Because that's a wicked day, that's not a good day. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reveal, will remove the Quran from earth, from the books, from the memory, and therefore people will have no access to the Quran anymore. Why we say it is a wicked generation, or part of it at least, or many of it, is because Allah, or Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said that when the day of judgment starts, it will start on the most wicked of people. So by the time we go to the end, people become wicked more and more and more, until when it starts the day of judgment, it will start on the most wicked of all people. But there will still be some Muslims who have a hint of Islam in them. Because we have in Sahih Muslim a hadith that there will be a day that people will have no knowledge about the religion at all. We explained that Allah will remove the knowledge by the death of the scholars, people ignoring the knowledge, and then it will disappear and the Quran will be removed from the books. Allah will take it back. So there will be a day when people will have no knowledge about the religion, except that one of them would say, I heard my ancestors say, or my relatives who died, say la ilaha illallah, and I say it today. So all what they have from this entire religion, with all these issues that the religion had, la ilaha illallah. He said, I don't know about the religion. It's in Sahih Muslim. I'm just telling you the words, the meaning of the words. I learned from those who died before us, our ancestors, our relatives, our parents, la ilaha illallah. So I'm saying it like they said it. So somebody asked one of the scholars of the hadith, what would la ilaha illallah do for them, having lost all knowledge about the religion? He said, they will enter with it to the Jannah. You know, because that's all they have in knowledge. Therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will enter them into Jannah, even for having just a statement that they inherited from the generation before them by saying that I say la ilaha illallah, like they said. Subhanallah. There's so much we can learn, brothers and sisters, from the religion. It's the most beautiful topic. And everyone is required to learn at least the foundations of the religion. If you take it as your job, you will find it is the most beautiful job of all time. That you know about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Those ahadith that we mentioned today, they're in the books. Just because we didn't hear about them today, doesn't mean anything. It means that we have shortcomings ourselves. But the hadith have been there sitting for hundreds of years for you to reach out, for you to learn, for you to practice, for you to say, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fulfilled His promise. And this is the result and the fruit of it. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us knowledge in the religion. Wa atim salam.
والذين يبيتون لربهم سجدا وقياما والذين يقولون ربنا اصرف عنا عذاب جهنم إن عذابها كان غراما